Testing, one, two, three. This will be the March 1st, 2017 City Council Workshop Meeting, followed by the regular meeting.
I'd like to call to order a City Council Workshop Meeting, March 1st, 2017, approximately 6:20 PM. And this is for the purpose of interviewing board applicants. We have quite a number of you here, and thank you very much for reapplying or applying, however that may fit. Since we have a lot of you, we know all of you. If we're quick with you up here, it's just 'cause you're returning and we know you, okay? So please don't take it that way. I'll take them sort of in the order that they're put in the book. Paul McCasey, if you would, please come up here to that mic. Introduce yourself, tell us a little bit about yourself. And let me announce this before we get going. The third Monday will be this new board's meeting date, okay? So please make sure third Mondays fit into your schedule if that's the board you're applying for, okay? Paul, please. Mic's yours.
Good evening. Paul McCasey. I live on 399 Old. Had that house since 1990. Now that I'm retired, started on Brooklyn Road. I had my own business. I was a contractor. I figured I'd give back to the community I'm going to be living in. I kind of love this area. It's on my beach. It's a beautiful area. And I'd like to get myself involved with the neighbors and the neighborhood.
Quick question. You've marked three boards here: Board of Adjustment, Community Redevelopment, and a Comprehensive Plan, which is now going to be the Plan and Advisory. Is any order there?
No, Frank.
Okay.
Quite frankly, wherever Fairwood Satellite Beach needs me, that's where I go.
Okay. Steve?
I don't have any questions. I think we'll just see where we can squeeze him in.
Welcome, Paul. Any issues you see in Satellite Beach that on your mind that need to be addressed? Anything that comes to mind that?
Nothing pressing other than maybe some sidewalks that are not installed in some areas, and when it rains, there's a little bit of flooding that might need to be looked at, but on hold. I don't see anything outstanding that needs to be removed.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you.
Paul, I just want to thank you for, for stepping up to volunteer. Most of the people that are here tonight are looking at the planning board. And if for some reason you don't get picked for that board, you're willing to sit on something else that when it comes up.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much for being here. Thanks for owning the house in Satellite Beach since 1990.
Okay. Question.
I'm sorry, would you say that?
I said, thanks for owning a house in Satellite Beach since 1990.
I don't have any questions. Just thank you for willing to offer up your time, and that would make our community great. We have so many people that are willing to do that, and I'm sure we can find somewhere for you.
Thank you. Okay, Alex?
Alex?
Yes.
Hi.
How you doing?
I am a software engineer by training, entrepreneur by trade. I had a couple internet companies and sold one with AOL, one to the next one. It's part of a bunch of startups in between here and there. But I also went on to be a vice president at AOL and fell in love with product strategy and sort of the corporate side of things or the business side of things. Was recruited by TED, went to TED as chief digital strategist for 4 years. Those of you familiar with TED Talks. Loved it. Probably the best job I'll ever have, but it's based in New York. My family was here. And I love Satellite Beach to the point where I wasn't willing to change that. So now, this past year, it's been developing a lifestyle and a workload that allows me to stay here, raise my family here, and just be around my siblings and my parents, my brother who lives off grant, 4 streets away. It's a huge blessing. It was a part of the code enforcement board since, I believe, 2008, 2009, whenever I moved back to the area. And I'm working the same world as a volunteer. I do have a lot of experience in strategy, I do have experience with small business. Planning and zoning has always been something I've been interested in. I think I wanted to do that my first game, but it was built up and not an element, so I just been fortunate instead.
Great, thank you. And the third Monday fits your schedule?
It does. I am coaching in the youth soccer right now, so the other Mondays I'll be gone, but I have stuff.
Okay, thank you very much. Cindy?
I have nothing.
Yeah.
I'm familiar with Alex.
Yep. Oh, I'll let you go that fast.
No, I've known Alex and his mother and father for years. Great people. Thank you for coming out again.
Nope, I don't have any other than, you know, appreciate you volunteering your time. But as you know, we're always looking for volunteers for the city, so we appreciate you giving back as we all do. Thank you very much for that.
Got a great community you want to be a part of.
Great. Thank you very much. I'll let you go now. David. Good evening. Third Monday, good with you?
Yeah, third Monday works good for me. I think I have actually personally talked to everybody, although Cindy, I don't know that I've ever met you.
I've never met you.
My name is David Delight, and I live over on Lee Avenue, 340 Lee Avenue. It was 12 and a half years ago I sat right here for the first time to be interviewed for joining the board. At that point, I had no idea, but I'll sort of reiterate the same comments because they've been true, which is I had every intention at that point. I lived here for a year, and I was pretty sure I was going to stay here forever, having moved from Wisconsin to Chicago, and I couldn't believe people lived in palm trees and sunshine year-round. So my intention at that point was to do whatever you wanted me to do, but I certainly expressed interest in the longer-term planning because I was thinking that way myself. I was only 27 at the time, and I'm worried now. But I still have the same impulse, which is I'm even more convinced that I'm going to stay here forever. I managed to recruit some family members to move into the area so that even shoring up my base. So I'm here to stay. I'm going to continue to contribute and break my story.
Thank you. Anybody have questions for him?
Nope, I know him.
Well, David, thank you for coming back out. Glad to have you.
Lynn?
Just born in Iowa, family in Wisconsin, I get it. Ended up here, so, yeah, that's good. Thank
I don't
you.
Know why people live there. I never knew that you could live in a place like this as opposed to a place like that. So as soon as I got wind of it, I like visiting.
For a week or so, visit.
I'm fine. I just thank you for all the time you spent on CPAB. You've been a part of a good team. And thank you.
I agree.
And you and Mike Golick, so I mean, it must be.
Yeah.
Okay. Dave, thanks very much. Appreciate it. For Neil Johnson, the date didn't work with him for the third Thursday, so he
third
has.
Monday.
Excuse
third
me,
Monday.
Third Monday.
Yeah.
Apologize.
Okay.
Alan.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Alan Mott with Tribune Drive. Been here for 23 years, retired from Harris after 30. And this is our home and plan on making it that way. Been on the Comprehensive Planning Board for a little over 2 years. Mm-hmm. Have enjoyed it, have enjoyed the direction that the city seems to stay on. Want to keep it that way. I am a advocate for the citizens of this city, the residents of this city, have no outside influences, and I want to be a voice for those people, for the residents.
Thank you very much. Mindy.
Any questions?
Alan, thank you for being on CPAB. You know, thank you for volunteering again.
Yes.
Nope, I've known him from CPAB also.
Just, Alan, thank you for the direction you provided on how we're doing and the direction we're going. It's good to hear every once in a while that everything seems to be where it needs to be. So thank you, and I have nothing else, Mr. Mayor.
All right. Alan, thanks. Appreciate CPAB. I listened to some of your comments and so forth, and I could tell they're very well thought out, and we appreciate your effort there.
Good. And thank we you. Appreciate your guidance.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
She was a Florida State graduate, too.
That's right.
That's a good thing for everybody.
Rodney.
Well, I come here with a change of heart. So many people want to get involved with our city. And it's heavy on my heart. We lived here 37 years. And I raised my family, no, our family. And I don't think I'm willing to there's good people, every one of them, and I want to decline. I want to decline because I've got a job at Clockworks. And I want to do things different.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very honorable.
Good. Yeah. Thank you, Rodney.
So, yeah.
Appreciate it.
And I understand everything. But I'm not taught very well. But I will have some patience, and I will improve. And, all right.
Rodney, let me tell you one thing, but that was Rodney and his angling for conservation. I know Dominic's part of it. I'm part of it. Incredible weekend. Mike, you guys put together that film thing. I believe last year, 2,500 kids got fishing rods and reels, something Rodney started years ago. And great organization, Rodney. Great.
Thank you.
Perfect.
And I just want to say, you know, you've been involved in our city for a long time. You've served on board, so thank you for all the time that you've devoted to our city. And I know you're going to still be around. You're not going anywhere.
Yes, and Steve.
I was going to say, my comment is you may not be on a board this time, but obviously we want to hear from you. Don't be silent.
Oh,
you won't be.
You know, we definitely want to hear from you. So your voice is important to us. Make sure we hear from you.
Yes. And thank you.
Thank you, Ron.
Thanks,
appreciate
Ron.
It very much, buddy. Thank you, buddy. Steve.
Steve Terry, live in Satellite Beach, 388 Cherry Court. Grown up here and moved away, come back, and now raise my family here. And want to be a part of the city and give back. I'm also an entrepreneur, small business owner, have been for 10 years, and feel that, you know, we're in construction, so being a part of this board would be right up our alley, and we like the direction the city's going, and we want to help keep it in that direction.
Great. Thank you.
And as I'm not saying PNC, is that what you were on PNC right before?
I was on PNC as well.
Right, that's what I thought. Nope.
Any particular issues that you see going on in the city that you think need to be addressed?
No, I want to continue to see the city go in the direction it's going, and there's definitely some projects that I see in the future that are coming up, and would like to see some of those go through.
Okay.
Third Monday works okay?
It does.
Okay, great. Ron.
Steve, I just want to thank you for applying. You're the only person from PZAB that you know, even applied for this. So, you know, a lot of the things that this board is going to be doing is what you've been doing. So I appreciate you applying for it. Thank you.
Thanks. Mindy.
no questions. Thank you for applying, and appreciate your time.
Yep, thank you. Appreciate it. Edmund. Good evening.
Mr. Mayor.
How are you, sir?
I'm doing fine. Ed Conagonis. I reside at 1343 Highway 1A, Unit 2A on the beach. I'm currently a volunteer with the Satellite Beach Police Department. I was privileged to serve on the code enforcement board for 15 minutes at my first and last meeting on site. Successfully adjudicated two cases. So I've got a 43-year professional career in federal law enforcement and private industry. More than half of that as senior manager and executive leadership positions. Those positions demanded that I be able to look at both tactical and strategic planning, performance to plan, and I think I did that quite successfully. And I think that that skill set and that experience and expertise is transferable to the planning board, which I'm applying for. If I am selected, obviously would serve with humility and integrity, well, with the best interest of the city of Satellite Beach in mind. And I would share with you one thing. As an executive leader and a senior manager, one of the things that I use to basically invigorate my team to be proactive and forward-leaning was a hockey analogy. And for those of you that are familiar with Wayne Gretzky, the great one, Wayne had a saying that I've lived by for a number of years, and that is, a good hockey player goes to where the puck is at. A great hockey player goes to where the puck will be.
True.
I appreciate being interviewed. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Steve?
No, but I can relate to your code enforcement experience. I sat on the board for 18 months and never had a meeting. So I can appreciate, well, at least you got your 15 minutes, because I didn't even get that.
I just want to say that's a good thing.
That is a good thing. I appreciate that. I'll give a lot of kudos to John over there for taking care of a lot of that. But I do appreciate you volunteering your time for this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Now, I remember your interview from last time, and I'm glad to see you came back out again. Thank you. I'd like to make it happen for you.
Well, what I said the last time was I would never volunteer for anything that didn't have word enforcement in it.
There you go.
I changed my mind.
Ed, thank you very much for volunteering again. I was there last night, and I got to see your 15 minutes of fame, and you did a great job.
Min?
I know you, Ed, so, you know, I got your back. But, you know, you said enforcement. Advisory is kind of similar to enforcement, so you're not really going back on your word too much, but we appreciate everything you do.
Thank you.
Ed, thanks for all your help with the police department, too.
Yeah.
I've seen you there. That's great. Thank you for reapplying. Sorry it was so short the last time. third Monday fits you fine?
Absolutely, okay. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Frank and I still want to drive the car, too.
Yeah. Okay. Make sure. I got Mike left here. Michael.
You haven't missed anything else. That was the only one.
Great, thanks.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Michael Rosos. I live on Rosada Street. Been in Paradise, also known as Satellite Beach, now for 3 years. I have a history in strategic planning, long-term, mid-term, out-year budgeting, emergency management. I was part of the Department of Homeland Security stand-up for emergency management for Florida. My last 2 weeks also prior to retiring. I worked with folks such as Craig Fugate back when he was with the State Emergency Planning Board, both for mass migration, hurricane planning, and any other disaster that Homeland Security covers. I love living here. My wife and I don't plan on making any changes on our own, but we plan on staying here. I'd like to be part of not only the present, but the future. And it's a nice mix. We have our young folks with families, we have our empty nesters, and we have our not-so-young folks who are in retirement stages. So we think it's a nice mix of people, and we think that this is a city that has vision, and I'd like to be a part of that vision. I consider myself to be a visionary, looking at the ways to do business.
Mike, I see here, you didn't check any of the boards. Is your, at least on my application here, are you more geared?
For the planning, yeah.
The plan advisory?
Yes.
The new one?
Yeah, it's a whole application.
Yeah, that's where I see it, so I just wanted to make sure. Questions for Mike? I've known Mike and had many talks with him.
I have none.
Mike, thanks. Yeah, I know you and your wife have gotten really involved, and just, we see you out all the time and involved in city things, and just thank you and thank both of you for being a part of this, attending the council meetings, and stepping up and just serving our community. We appreciate it.
Our privilege to serve.
Thank you. Questions for Mike, anybody here?
No, okay.
I just want to thank you for applying, and thanks, Sharon. You guys jumped in with both feet, moving into Satellite Beach and doing the things you do for our city, so thank you very much.
Mondays aren't bad. Ed is my road patrol partner. Mondays are done at 3.
To all the applicants, thank you very much. I know you've participated in the city and on other boards and so forth, and thank you for reapplying. We appreciate it, and your service is greatly appreciated. Any further business? Thank you, and we will contact everyone on this. Meeting's adjourned. That's not it. Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call to order a regular meeting of the City Council of Satellite Beach, March 1st, 2017, approximately 7 p.m. Please join Councilman Gibson for a moment of silence and the pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. At this time, moving on to agenda item 3, citizens' comments. Before I do this, I apologize here for one second. We have the real Mr. Osmer in our audience tonight, and I want to say it correctly, Mayor Osmer, welcome. Thank you. Sorry, you got to put up with it. Okay, moving on to agenda item 3, citizens' comments, and this is for non-agenda items. Floor is open for non-agenda items. Okay, hearing none, move on to city council comments. Mindy?
Not much. We went to the Civ Mill dinner, got to meet some pretty interesting people. This is my first experience with something like that, so got to talk to Bill Posey and several colonels, and it was an interesting group of people, and I would look forward to doing it again at some point. And Mayor's Fitness Challenge is kicking off pretty good. Just so you guys know, I'm talking to Health First because I don't think they're calculating our minutes properly, because we have truly had the most minutes by far, and their mathematical equation that they're using is wrong. I think it's wrong, so that means it's wrong. So we're going to try to get that, because we haven't won any week so far. So
we're the smallest population, the most participants by far,
and the most minutes,
and the logged most minutes, but for some reason we're not winning.
Yeah.
The challenge.
You gotta figure
that
one out.
Doesn't make any sense. No. Logically, it doesn't make any sense.
Well, it's supposed to be relative to the size of the city, and they're not taking that into relation. Basically, they're just taking how many people are logged in, what are the minutes, and what's the amount of minutes per person. But that doesn't take into consideration that Palm Bay has 110,000 people. We have 10,000. So who is the healthiest city? Well, it's how many minutes, I think, per your population. So anyways, I'm very competitive, in case you can't tell. So
don't get her mad.
So that's all I have to say. Thanks.
Dominic?
I'm putting my minutes in, because I'm doing a lot of stuff. Monday, myself and several other elected officials in the county met with Representative Randy Fine. He is the sponsor of House Bill 17. And we sat down with him and discussed our issues with House Bill 17, and You know, the reality is, this is a leadership bill from the Speaker of the House, and that's where this is coming from. So stay tuned, because House Bill 17 has extreme detrimental effects to communities across the state of Florida, not just Satellite Beach.
That's the one that deals with businesses and...
It would basically take over our ability to regulate zoning, anything. You know, anything that is not constitutionally protected, and zoning is not, could be under the auspices of the legislature of the state of Florida. So home rule in our city, along with our county and every other city in the state of Florida, pretty much goes away.
Okay.
On many items. Last night I attended the final code enforcement board meeting, and on behalf of the city, I thanked all of the members of the board and David Dyer, our attorney for the board. But I neglected to thank John Stone and his staff for the work that they've done over the years on that board, because that was your bailiwick. And I also forgot to thank Jim Beadle, who has been the attorney for the city for that board since its inception. And I just wanted to pass that along, Jim, from last night. I'm sorry I didn't think of it last night, but I remembered it when I got home, and I wanted to at least say that tonight. So it was a good meeting, and actually got some stuff done. So
I just like to talk about the walk we did there with Bob Gabordi from Florida Today. I've actually ran into a few other citizens that a couple of that were there, and a couple that wish they would have been there, and talked about future plans of definitely hitting those. I think that's always a good thing. I like that, you know, he'll tell you that he does a lot of his walks here in Satellite Beach. He does a lot up there in Hightower. That we are his favorite place for him to walk. So it can't be all bad when, you know, the managing editor of Florida Day wants to keep announcing that Satellite Beach is his place to walk on a beach early morning, evening, stuff like that. So I really enjoyed it. I heard a lot of positive comments from that. That was it.
I have nothing, sir.
Thank you. I attended CivMil. I did walk on the beach. Bob also. That was very nice. Also, I attended the first night of Citizens Police Academy. Again, I think they filled the class. Pretty amazing group of people at the police station there. Do a great job. And if you have an opportunity, if you haven't taken that class, the next time it comes up, I think it's something very worthwhile, and they do a great job with it. That's all I have.
Mayor, I think we should point out, too, that you and I did beat the city manager back from that walk that morning.
No.
not that she's not competitive either.
They ran past me, and I ran past them.
Yes, there are some competitive...
Wait, is that her to run?
There are some competitive people up on this council. Okay. Thank you, city going on to agenda item 5, city manager's report. You're on.
Thank you, Mayor. On March 4th, please join us for our citywide garage sale. And just let everybody know, I'm getting over the flu, so if I don't shake your hand later, that's why. I don't want to spread it. Hopefully I'm not contagious anymore, but that's why I'm talking like this. we do have a citywide garage sale on March 4th. This is going to be at our community center from 8 until noon, and there's two ways to participate in this. You can either rent a table and have your own stuff out at the table, or you can participate over the weekend, turn in your address to the rec center, and they publish a list of all the addresses in Satellite Beach that are having a garage sale that day. And that way you can sell from your home instead of at the actual community center. But do come by our booth. The city will have our own booth, and all of the proceeds from our booth will be going to Relay for Life. Also, the next weekend, stop by the city's second annual fire truck pole challenge on March 11th, and this is also at the community center from 7:30 to 4. There's numerous teams that get together within fire departments across the county that enter into this contest, and they raised quite a bit of money the last year. It was a lot of fun. So if you have a chance to stop by there, there'll be also, I think they're having food trucks there too, and stuff and entertainment for the kids too.
Speaking of House bills and Senate bills, House Bill 17, like you said, has some pretty big ramifications. I just wanted the community to know that two newspapers thus far across the state, Tallahassee, the Tallahassee Democrat and the Gainesville Sun, have both published articles by the newspaper against this bill, basically saying it's a power grab by the state. And some of the things I just want to outline for the community that this bill will affect, this will affect things like noise ordinances. This will affect, you know, when people want, like, for example, a construction company isn't allowed to start construction before 7 o'clock here in our community. Well, this would make that go away. There would be no way to regulate that anymore. Some of the other things that would it would impact would be, like, our alcohol sale hours.
Businesses and neighborhoods.
Right. Right, our parking laws, all of our nuisance laws, basically, fire inspections, fees, anything that would go, sign regulations, anything that would affect business. The other thing is Mr. Fine has, I put this on our Facebook page, the city's Facebook page, and he actually got on there and responded and said that it doesn't impact zoning, which we have to disagree with. And the reason why we disagree with that is, I've been a planning director prior to being city manager for 10 years, and I know of no statute that expressly authorizes us to zone anything. And that's what the statute says, or what the bill says, is that we have to be expressly authorized to do whatever the state allows us to do. And our zoning powers come from police powers in the Florida Constitution and federal case law. So there's no statute authorizing us to zone. It may reference zoning, and it may reference land development regulations, but it doesn't authorize us to zone anything. So because when you see a disagreement like that, that leads to future lawsuits. So if we decide, okay, let's say it passes, and we say, you know what, we're going to pretend it does apply to zoning, and then a business disagrees with that, then we're in court. And that's just a self-perpetuating issue. So not only is the bill problematic because we disagree with the issues, you know, the impacts, but also because the language of it's so broad and can be interpreted in so many ways that, that type of legislation just inevitably leads to future lawsuits. So obviously we have an issue with that bill. We have an issue with a couple other ones regarding there's a bill out that relating to utilities, House Bill 687, which would allow a cell phone company to put, cell phone
antennas
in our right of way without our permission. We have right of ways and easements in people's backyards, so obviously we have a problem with that. There's a big attack on home rule authority this year, and it's probably bigger than I've seen in a while. Mm-hmm. There is a good bill, which we're hoping to support, is Senate Bill 80, which is public records. And then there's two bills filed by Debbie Mayfield, one with regarding the railway safety, and then another one with regards to pharmaceutical drugs and how the companies are required to keep the drugs that they have on the list for you during your plan period. And those two bills that are good, and so we're outlining some thank you letters for her and things like that. But this is an interesting session. We will be leaving for that for Tallahassee in a couple weeks, and we are meeting with our representatives, as you said, now. Police department has kicked off the Citizens Academy. Their classes are completely full. We have a waiting list already. The fire department is hosting another Living Healthy workshop series beginning every Tuesday, February 28th to April 4th from 1 to 3:30. And you can register that workshop series with the email in my report. And the staff would like to thank City Council for your ongoing support for our Relay for Life events. The next event is the city table at our citywide garage sale, and our team has thus far raised $3,500 for Relay for Life. Also, the city's first bat house has been installed at the city's beachfront property at the end of Elwood, and a ribbon cutting ceremony will be held on Friday, March 3rd at 5 p.m.
and that would be Ms. Kirsten Paulson, who came in and approached you all, so she'll be at that to cut the ribbon.
She's going to be the ribbon cutter, correct?
Yes, she will be the ribbon cutter. We normally like the mayor to do that, but she's cuter.
No, I think she's fine. And then once we get them all up, we'll have her in, we can present her with something?
Yes.
I think it'd be great.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
And I did want to thank John Stone also, if he's here, right? Yeah, he was a big reason why that is all getting done right now, as well as Nick who actually helped install it. You two installed it, right? Yep.
Was it at the beach property?
Yep.
Or was it at the little park?
Well, it was not a beach property. It said beach property, but...
Yeah, no, it was at the little park.
Little park within the county.
Oh, okay, I thought you were putting it at the beach property. So I have it wrong.
Yeah, the little park, just to clarify. And I saw it, it looked really good, you guys did a good job.
Right. Okay. Courtney, you have an action item?
I have one action item. Due to Hurricane Matthew, two sets of bleachers were destroyed, and the sign and facade of the David R. Schechter Community Center was damaged. And although these are unbudgeted items, we are requesting council authorization to proceed with a bid process to complete the repair and replacement process. And we expect some of these costs to be offset by insurance proceeds and FEMA reimbursement. So basically, we're asking you to help us bypass the agenda item process to be able to put it out to bid and get it done because of the hurricane.
Motion to proceed with bid process.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilman Breimer, second by Vice Mayor Osmer. Courtney, so we are filing for the insurance and FEMA, but we're just going to, since we need this at our field, we're going to do it and then just get reimbursed, correct?
All FEMA's reimbursement. So, okay. Yeah, so we would have to put it in first and then get reimbursed.
Okay, great. Mm-hmm. Since this is an action item at this time, I'll open up for public comment. Hearing none, back to council. Further council comments? Lenore?
Councilman Gibson?
Yes.
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osmer?
Yes.
Councilman Breimer?
Yes.
Mayor Patino?
Yes, motion passes. Any further city manager information?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. At this time, Courtney, on our next agenda, we have a time, 7:30. Mm-hmm. We should be able to complete this. And agenda item 6, take action on the Satellite Beach Community Garden Project.
No. He's got a full presentation for you.
Okay.
So I would go to the next item.
Sounds great. Okay, let me just, I'm going to come back to this. Ordinance review, first reading. No, we're going to do agenda item 12 with council's permission. Discuss, take action on agreement with Foss Law Firm for the Code Enforcement Special Magistrate Service.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yep. Something quick.
Good.
Okay.
There we go.
Suzanne, I think that's your.
I'm getting there. You want me to finish? Okay.
This is a follow-up item we had at our last city council meeting where you approved the award of the RFP number 1617-02 for Code Enforcement Special Magistrate Services to both law firm LLP, and this agenda item is simply bringing back to the agreement between the city and Riggs law firm that Attorney Beagle has reviewed and both attorneys are agreeing on. So not much to say, it just basically solidifies our relationship and the fact that he will be our code enforcement special magistrate.
Right. Jim, the agreement you're good with?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Do I have a motion?
Motion to authorize city manager to execute an agreement for code enforcement special magistrate services with Voss Law Firm.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilman Breimer, second by Vice Mayor Osmer. At this time, open up for public comment on agenda item 12. Hearing none. Back to council. Council comments? Lenore?
Councilman Gibson?
Yes.
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osler?
Yes.
Councilman Breimer?
Yes.
Mayor Patino?
Yes. Motion passes.
We're going to take number 9.
Yep. Sounds great. Moving on to agenda number 9, discuss take action on agreement with the State of Florida Department of Environmental Protection. Alan?
Good evening. In April of 2015, City Council, many of you were there at that time, authorize the city to move forward with a grant application for 319 for the DeSoto Parkway, or I'm sorry, the DeSoto Park Stormwater Improvement Project. We finally received the contract last week. It took quite a while to get back. There were some issues in Tallahassee, some questions about our eligibility, but that was all straightened out. So now we are asking for authorization to sign the contract and move forward with the project.
Thank you very much. Al, on this, are we waiting for the permit yet?
Yes, we met with St. John's, yesterday, Dan and I, to go over the permit and what we're going to need. And so that's moving forward as well.
Great, thank you. Questions from council?
Nope. I'd make a motion to authorize the staff to sign the Section 319 grant in the amount of $950,000 to construct stormwater system improvements in the DeSoto Parkway drainage basin. The total project cost of $950,000, comprised of grant funding of $560,500 and a city match of $389,500 to come from the Stormwater Utility Fund or the Capital Assets Fund.
Second. A motion by Vice Mayor Osmer, second by Councilman Breimer. Discussion from council? Hearing none. At this time, open up agenda item 9 for public comment. Hearing no public comment, back to council.
And Mayor, I just wanted to clarify that $389,500, the staff will be applying for a TMDL grant to cover 50% of that. So I just wanted to make sure you understood that.
Great.
And the permit hopefully doesn't take us another year or we lose the cycle for the grant?
No, it won't. The way that St. John was approaching it yesterday seemed that it was going to be pretty smooth.
Right.
I think the only trip up might be with the manatees and the kayak launch.
Okay. But the pond, which is really the critical.
Right.
Yeah, and we can always take that, sever that out to keep moving it forward and get that done later. If we see that issue, we will, to make sure that we don't jeopardize the grant.
Okay, thank you. Further comments?
I'm glad it's moving where it's moving.
Yep, we need to get it done. Lenore?
Councilwoman Gibson?
Yes.
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Councilman Breimer?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osmer?
Yes.
Mayor Patino?
Yes, motion passes. Okay, thank you. Agenda item 11 has been taken off. And that would leave.
Can we do 10?
We can do 10? Okay. This time, open up a public hearing. Discuss, take action on ordinance 1138. Jim?
Ordinance number 1138, an ordinance of the City of Satellite Beach, Brevard County, Florida, amending the City Board Handbook created by ordinance 1101 to create and include Sustainability Board, establishing the duties, composition, terms of office, support staff designation, and day of meeting for Sustainability Board. Amending the City Board Handbook to combine functions and duties of the current Comprehensive Planning Advisory Board, CPAB, and the Planning and Zoning Advisory Board, PZAB, in one board to be known as the Planning Advisory Board. Repealing all references to CPAB in the City Board's Handbook. Amending all references to PZAB in the City Board's Handbook to Planning Advisory Board. Amending reference to CPAB to Planning Advisory Board and duties of Recreation Board. Amending charter number references regarding boards, deleting Florida Administrative Code reference in the City Board Handbook, providing severability, and providing an effective date. That's the second reading of ordinance number 1138.
Motion to
approve ordinance number 1138 on second reading.
A motion by Councilman Montanaro, second by Councilman Breimer.
And Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
I just want to make one comment. The issue about the staggered terms that Courtney brought up at the last meeting is actually going to be, it's actually contained in section 2. On page 2-2,
okay.
And the line says the term of office for board members shall be for 3 years unless staggered terms are required or deemed appropriate by City Council.
Thank you very much. Further discussion?
No, Council.
This time, open up public comment on agenda item 10. Hearing them, back to Council. Hearing no further, Lenore?
Councilwoman Gibson?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osmer?
Yes.
Councilman Breimer?
Yes.
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Mayor Cuttino?
Yes, motion passes. Think we have enough time for eight? Okay. Move on to agenda number eight, discuss take action on ordinance 1135. Jim?
Ordinance number 1135, an ordinance of the City of Satellite Beach, Brevard County, Florida, revising the future land use map by redesignating the property known as the Pelican Coast PUD from RLA Residential Low A Density to MU RLA PUD Mixed Use Residential Low A Density Planned Unit Development, and amending the future land use element of the 1998 Comprehensive Plan as amended May 4, 2016, based on the city's updated data and analysis of the Comprehensive Plan, revising and updating existing goals, objectives, and policies in accordance with the mandate set forth in Chapter 163 Florida statutes, authorizing transmittal of these amendments to the East Central Florida Regional Planning Council, State Land Planning Agency, and other applicable agencies for review and comment as required by Florida statutes, providing conflicts clause and severability clause, and providing an effective date. It's the first reading of Ordinance 1135.
Thank you. Discussion from council.
You want Jim to give a brief?
Thank you, Mayor. If you don't mind, I'll just give a brief. It's not nearly as complicated as it sounds when you read it. You actually, for a number of years, when you've taken the Pelican Coast area into the City of Satellite Beach, you had a PUD area with the zoning regulation by which you took the Pelican Coast area in. Over the years, the designation of the RLA for the Pelican Coast area had a little section on it that said throughout the PUD, and over the time of the years that went by, that went away. So if you think about it, those of us that were new to Satellite Beach, I worked with you 10 years or more, that RLA area designation no longer had the word PUD on it throughout the PUD, but you have all the zoning that implements that is the PUD. And now in the future, you're going to be having some development aspects that would have to do with how the PUD zoning would be in compliance in terms of hotel use and some of those things that will come back to you with your PUD ordinance. But in looking at it from an outside standpoint, we needed to designate it so it's separate from the RLA area throughout the rest of the city. So that's why you have the two things that are there. One that is the text amendment, which says it allows, which it always has, the mixed-use residential low A density planned unit development, and that's a limited commercial usage, which cannot be more than 10%, and it's in your specific PUD zoning districts that would also have to be amended. So what you're having is a renaming of this to separate it from the RLA. Probably more of a language than you wanted me to explain, but that's what it is. It's a redesignation, a renaming, to make sure it's distinct from the other. It does come to you with a recommendation from the CPAB, and if there are any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
Thank you very much. Questions? Council? Okay, at this time, open up for public comment on this agenda item.
Richard Heights, Satellite Beach. I'm just trying to understand why we need more condos. I mean, we have, you're building almost 400 townhouses. I'm not sure how many condos are going up in front of Publix, but we can't handle any more development. We've proved that many times. All the stuff we've dumped in the river, now we're paying a tax, you know, to clean it up. We're not doing anything to prevent it. We're just building more stuff. You're going to concrete everything over and it's going to run into the river. And, you know, you can't hardly drive down South Patrick anymore for the cars. You're going to probably add another 1,000 cars with the stuff that's being built now. You know, and I'm just, having a hard time understanding why we need to go do this.
Thank you, and I'll answer a little bit. In Florida, property rights issues, we have been strongly hit a lot of times when we do not allow people to use their property for the intent in which it is zoned for. So those properties have been zoned for that. That whole unit has been zoned.
Well,
when we took that particular area over, okay, it has been zoning. There's 110 acres there that's not built on. It's zoned for, if I'm not mistaken, 500 houses at the present time, which was part of the agreement when we took this property over from the government. Okay?
Well,
so this area is really, what we're doing is more clarifying.
You're clarifying what's there.
On what's there. We haven't changed what was intended to go.
Well,
there.
I mean, the way this reads to me.
I understand. I mean, I sit on the board, and I listen to it, so I've got the opportunity to hear it more than once. But I can assure you, we're not really getting more. We're clarifying what is already allowed at the piece. To give you a little background real quickly on the condos being built across from Publix. We acquired approximately 4 acres of land in trade for allowing that density to be put there.
On the beach.
On the beach. So we have a park at the end of Elwood, if my memory stays me, that you can no longer build on. So at that time when that came to us years ago, a lot of us felt we're building it across from a commercial area, Publix anyway, and we saved that piece of property from having a condo on it that was legally allowed to be built. He was 2 weeks away from starting. So, yes, a lot of us don't like it, but that particular parcel was more of a trade so we could save a parcel. But it's very hard in this state to tell a landowner where the property is zoned. He can't build that zone.
Yeah.
So
the way I read this, it was zoned for low density, and we were changing it to allow all these other things.
And it does look like that, but basically the zoning didn't match what this is, which is the land use. So they have the zoning rights to build condominiums and commercial, but the land use is telling you guys, or the public, that they can only build residential, which is not the case. So that's why we are changing it.
Okay, well, that makes a little more sense to me.
I mean, we understand your thing about the lagoon and so forth, and that's why the last agenda item about filling that stormwater pond on DeSoto, we are working every which way we can. We've purchased some land at the end of Park Avenue, not Park,
Jackson,
for stormwater, so I can assure you that we work for making it a cleaner environment as probably, and I want to say this, probably more than any city.
Well, new development, too, has a lesser impact than the old development because new development has to comply with today's stormwater standards. The old development, like my house, doesn't have stormwater. I mean, my house was built in 1963. So in my whole area around it, and that's why the city right now, we're building stormwater ponds to address old neighborhoods because they didn't have any stormwater. So the new development actually is better than the old development.
Is there any plans to do something about the traffic?
That's going to be a tough one.
Yeah, there's not much you can do.
Right.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you for your input. We appreciate you coming. Podium still open? Hearing no further, back to council.
Motion to approve ordinance 1135, first reading.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilman Breimer, second by Councilman Montanaro. Further discussion? Lenore?
Councilwoman Gibson?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osmer?
Yes.
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Councilman Breimer?
Yeah.
Mayor Patino?
Yes, motion passes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mayor.
Appreciate your hard work
on it.
Thank
you, Jim.
Councilman, we'll come back to you again when the DEO reviews this. We hope it will be very short time period.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
At this time, I apologize for being a few minutes late here. We'll move back to agenda item 7, discuss take action on the audit report for FY15-16 by Carr, Riggs, and Ingram. Thank you.
Hi. Good evening. I'm Yvonne Claiborne with Carr, Riggs, and Ingram. With me this evening, I have Debbie Good, who is partner in charge of our Melbourne office, and also the quality control reviewer for this project, and in charge for this audit, David Norton, and we also joining us this evening. This is your audit report for the fiscal year ended September 30, 2016. Looking back in time, not looking back as far as we did last year, but we are looking back in time. So, real quickly, we won't spend a ton of time on this evening, because I know we have other things on your agenda items. The opinion on your financial statements starts on page 5. Our audit opinion is an unmodified audit opinion, which is the highest level of audit assurance you can receive. We're opining on the material presentation of your financial statements in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. Again, we're not looking for 100%. We're looking for material compliance, and the city complied in all material respects. The management discussion and analysis starts on page 7. I always encourage the users of the financial statements, if you're only going to read one piece, read the management discussions and analysis. It does a nice summary of giving you a comparison of your financial results from this year to the prior year. It also presents you with some internal management decisions and thought processes on what's going on with the city. The financial statements, the basic financial statements, start on page 19. We have two types of statements, the government-wide statements, the statement of net position, and the statement of activities. You're only going to see one time a year in this document, and this document alone is not the same. It's a slightly different method of accounting than you use in your internal financial reporting. The statement of net position right now for the city shows an ending a total net position of $21 million. $25 million of that is in your investment in capital assets net of the related debt. You have a $5.4 million unrestricted deficit. I'd like to remind the users, this is a full accrual financial statement, and what this does is it records things like your long-term debt that you're not going to pay in any one year, you're going to pay over time. It also records your net pension liability and then your other post-employment liabilities. These are liabilities that are down the road. These are not liabilities that are going to be liquidated with today's dollars, and it's projected out for a period of time. And those liabilities will come due at some point, but this financial statement really just reminds you that basically there's a future obligation for the city to pay these as they come due. And so the 5.4 really represents a future obligation of the city. It's not a indication when you look at the statutory rules around financial condition. This doesn't come into play. We look at trends, and right now against your peer cities, it's an inconclusive trend because they're all dealing with a net pension liability at the same time you are. And that's really the big trigger. And I will say 2 years from now, we'll be coming back, and this number could potentially get even less attractive with the change in the other post-employment benefit rules, kind of like the painful process we just went through with pensions. We're going to be doing the same thing with the accounting rules for your other post-employment benefits. So stay tuned for that. But again, this is not... We don't look at this, and your lenders don't look at this and go, oh, wow, this is awful. They look at this and say, okay, we understand that you've got a future pay-as-you-go liability that at some point is going to come to you.
Can I interrupt you real quick?
Sure.
In just layman's terms, when you have a business, you typically don't carry a pension liability because your business may go under at any day, whereas the city isn't going to go under any day. So we carry pension liabilities because we like to keep taxes low, and we know that we don't have to pay it today. So that's why we have a liability. The state likes to make us change the rules a lot, where we have to report things in certain ways that make everybody go, oh my God, and it's really not, oh my God. it's not as horrible as it seems. So I just want to make sure everybody understands that.
And I will say that our city is in a much better position than a lot of the other cities in the state of Florida, because I am the chairman of the Florida Municipal Pension Trust Fund for the League of Cities, and we monitor 260 some odd pension funds in the state of Florida, and Satellite Beach is in a very good position compared to many of the other cities in the state.
The other luxury you don't have is that in the commercial world, when the Financial County Standards Board for the commercial environment changed the rules and had them start reporting this net pension liabilities. A lot of them did away with their defined benefit plans, and they took away pension programs from their employees and moved them into defined contribution plans or that didn't get to have to record this liability. You don't have that, plus as a city, you're not going to do that to your employees. It's a trade-off. So, again, it's just an idea of what's coming down the road. And like Courtney said, you're not going to tax your taxpayers today to try to fund a liability that's not going to come due for many years down the road. From the fund financial statements, which start on page 22 and 23, these are the financial statements that you're used to seeing. That this is your internal financial reporting. I'm just going to point out two numbers on page 22 in your general fund. Your unassigned fund balance is sitting at $421,000. The committed fund balance is $852,000. That's your stabilization money that the city has continued to fiscally set aside dollars for sustainability. And they did add to the dollars this year in accordance with your ordinance. And so that amount is sitting at $852,000. And again, leaving you still with unassigned fund balance that is discretionary at the council's pleasure of $421,000. On page 24, the current year performance, the net change in fund balance, which is the third line from the bottom for the general fund, was a decrease of $47,000, which as auditors, we consider that pretty much a break even. So the city did what you said you were going to do in terms of paying the bills and covering them. On that, the CRA, the Capital Assets Fund, and your non-major funds, we always like to remind everybody your CRA fund and your special revenue funds, and your Capital Assets Fund as well. Those monies are set aside to be spent. It is not the intent for you to accumulate fund balance in those accounts, so for those accounts to go down, simply means that you're spending the money for the for purpose which it was designated. It's not a negative reflection at all. So the one we look for to show fiscal sustainability, of course, is your general fund, but those other funds, again, are being set aside dollars for specific purposes. The only thing you had new this year was your health insurance fund. In terms of it's reported as a proprietary fund, it's really an internal service fund. This is the program now that pays for your employees' health insurance benefits. The charges for services of $1.2 million are the charges that were paid by the departments of the city that were participating in the plan, and it paid out claims of $1 million. The pension trust funds, the discussion about the pension plans, got even lengthier this year. I didn't think it was possible, but it did. Starts on page 56 and talks about the different pension plans. You got the same plans that you had last year. Again, this footnote will provide you all kinds of information, including the sensitivity analysis of what would happen if the investment rate of return or the discount rate be used, which is based on your long-term investment rate of return, were to change by 1%, either up or down. And that impact on there. The police and fire plan did add that defined contribution component, the share plan, and the city of Satellite Beach did fund that, and so that information is now in the system on, or in the footnote on page 66. That shows you the police officers and firefighters defined benefit plan, which is the plan that the actuary deals with in terms of generating a net pension liability, and also has the defined contribution share plan there as well. And the required supplementary information, it has the information on your pension plans as of September 30, 2016, the net position of the pension plan for your police and fire plan as compared to the net position of the investments is 70.75%, and for your general employees it's 79.57%. The internal control report in the back last year, we had a comment related to the cash receiving process. That item has been remediated and corrected by the city. We removed that comment. This year, the only comment we had, which was a minor control recommendation related to the bank reconciliation process, in a city the size of the city of Satellite Beach and the number of staff that you have a limited number of staff in your accounting and finance department, one of the most difficult challenges they have is to provide for an appropriate segregation of duties, which we as auditors love to see this complete separation, but we know in a city this size, you can't have that. So we look for these mitigating controls. In this case, the bank reconciliations were being prepared by one person, and then they were going to another person that was preparing some journal entries to go into the books. But there was no formal review of the bank reconciliation. So all we're asking is that somebody independent of the person that prepared the bank reconciliation make sure that they document that they reviewed it, and that way you have some level of assurance that you don't have one person doing all things. And that was it. And with that, we were very pleased with how well things went this year. I think we made a lot of improvements working with city staff on the financial statement presentation, and certainly we had a lot better conversations this year as far as we really got to do some deep dives in some areas that we felt like were important. And with that, I'll entertain any questions.
Great. Thank you very much to the staff also. Jennifer, thank you very much. Zenz, thank you. Comments from the council on the report?
No. I just want to thank Yvonne and Debbie. You always have done wonderful work for us in the past, and this is another example of, our doing things right, and you pointing out when we need to, do some things different. So thank you for working with us.
Thank you. I'll come back to council at this time. I'll open up this agenda item for public comment. The floor is open for public comment on the report. Hearing none, back to council. Any further council?
I just wanted to say, thank you to my staff. You guys have done a great job. I know when we first started, the audit process was a little bit more difficult. And now that we've had Jennifer here, it's made it a lot more easier to go through. And this is probably the first year that we've received a recommendation and not a management comment and not, something that we had to deal with and correct. And so I think, we've made such good strides in the finance department. It's largely because of Jennifer's work. So we appreciate you and thank you. And also thank you, Yvonne. We appreciate it.
Thank you. At this time, motion
to accept the audit report for fiscal year 15-16 by Carr, Riggs, and Ingram.
I got a motion by Councilman Brimer, second by Councilwoman Gibson. Further discussion from council?
Nope.
Hearing none. Lenore?
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osborne?
Yes.
Councilwoman Gibson?
Yes.
Councilman Brimer?
Yes.
Mayor Cittino?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Staff? Thank you very much for your hard work.
So you don't tell that.
Great job. Okay, moving on at this point, we've done this.
Six.
We're going to go back to agenda item six, discuss take action on Satellite Beach Community Garden Project. Nick?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Council. We're going to get started with a review of the workshop we presented earlier in the month on 2017. Workshop was an idea to get the community involved and we can take any comments from the sustainability board before moving on to council. So at the workshop, we presented some recommendation topics. So those include the community garden plot size and the footprint area, which the community garden will exist, the planting bed sizes and material costs, irrigation systems, rain barrels, and city water, and the aesthetic options that would be included in the community garden, the timeline for the project and project launch, the methods of sale for planting beds themselves, the return on investment, and any other ideas that the sustainability board thought would be a good idea to include in the community garden. In the packet presented, you'll see all the text in yellow was the text that was added on after the workshop as recommendations from the sustainability board. So as discussed at the workshop, the total area footprint is 7,650 square feet. This is going to be just south of the racquetball courts at DeSoto. That size was recommended, and then we moved on to the utilizing of the existing landscape for that area, dealing with any shade that might impact the community garden, and dealing with that necessarily with creating an S shape for the community garden to avoid any excess shade that might hinder any of the garden activity. The number of planting beds was selected to be 20 planting beds. This would be a good pilot size for the program, and we can always go on and add additional planting beds from there. And moving on to the next slide, sorry about that. The planting bed size was designed to reflect that and was successful at FIT. So we went with a 4 foot wide by 2 foot tall by 8 foot long bed size. This makes it accessible for kids and adults so that everybody would be able to take part in the program. We decided to change my original design and go with something a little simpler. Originally there was an idea to have a storage container attached to it. That was done away with, and the simple 4 by 2 by 8 bed was selected. I gave them the options of treated lumber or cedar wood. After lengthy discussion, we determined that the treated lumber was acceptable due to the fact that arsenic is no longer included in the treated wood. That was the main concern with using treated wood. So I provided them with two options, one of them being cedar, one of them being treated wood. The cost of the cedar was almost double. The only benefit was the aesthetic benefit of the cedar. So looking at the budget, keeping the budget solid, we went with the treated lumber. So the cost of each bed is going to be $110. This includes the wood and all the screws, any materials involved in constructing it. And this was what we used to create our budget. For next is irrigation. The recommendation to use both city water and rain barrels seemed to be the most well received. This way, if there was some rain, we could collect rainwater. If we run out of rain, we hit the drought period, we can tap into the city irrigation. We can use both. So the cost of that associated using 10 foot PVC priced out and rain barrels, $1,000 for that. So those aesthetic options that I mentioned earlier, possibly a trellis or a bench, the citizens thought it'd be really nice to include a fence of some kind, so we discussed fence options, and we landed on a simple rope fence would be both practical and cost efficient. Something that can delineate the area for residents to feel like they have ownership of the community garden, and yet also create a barrier for anybody outside to feel like they're, you know, if they want to be part of it, they can do so, but they can just walk right into it. So that cost is about $300. And the dates and timeline in green, you'll see the first one in March and April. You know, if approved by council this evening, we'll move forward with working with Lowe's and Public Works to create a list of all these materials and getting them purchased. And then once the materials have been purchased in May and June, we can begin looking at construction and hopefully everything constructed by June, working with school groups like the Scouts or any other clubs like ROTC. Once that's done, we'll begin pre-sale of the planting beds. Actually, we've already received a lot of support for this, and we already have 10 people that are interested in the beds. I imagine it will be no problem to get the other 10 taken care of before we reach our target launch for September. So the ribbon cutting being in September, this is after communicating with UF IFAS and Linda Seals at IFAS when the best time for planting is. There will be some issues with planting during the summer, so instead of dealing with extra insects or problems, we're just going to go straight to a September launch. We'll give us more time to talk about any language regarding the agreement between residents and the community garden. Give us more time to kind of iron out everything before we start. So the methods of sale and tracking them for all these beds and the costs associated with them will be let people know about it through Beachcaster, Southeast website, and to keep everything on record, we'll probably use PayPal or something like that to keep everything track of how much it costs, where it goes, who is the one involved, and things like that. You know, we mentioned the idea of flyers or door to door, but again, since we've already had 10 people requesting beds already, probably don't have to worry about that. So the ROI is something we'll talk about in detail. If we have 20 beds at $110 each, $2,200 there, the cost of the trellis and the aesthetic options for the bench and the rope fence for $300, associated irrigation costs for $1,000, and the soil and compost for $1,500, we reach a target budget of $5,000 for the entire project. That ROI was looked at in metrics of success, looking at these impacts on the environment, the social, the society, community, and the economics. It looks to us that the best solution for the ROI is to reinvest the costs and reinvest the money earned through selling the beds right back into the program. In doing this, we can pay for all the maintenance and keep this all in-house and keep this all maintained without having to look for more funding in the future. That will keep us with really sustainable costs, and we can do that with $1,000 each year coming in from the sale of those beds, and then every year we'll go out and we'll do that again. So if every year we create $1,000 income, we can go ahead and put that right back in there. Anything we don't spend on maintenance or internal costs, we can use to create more beds in the future. Any other ideas we had involved adding solar pumps or lights to the community garden, creating a community garden network that would be rather successful, being that there is already an FIT community garden that we're working with to model the community garden. We work with them closely, and also, like I said, you know, IFAS, they have a community garden at Wickham, creating a kind of network. The idea was pushed around to create a Facebook page where people could go, comment, share pictures, photos, stories, and maybe gardening tips and ideas. That was something that I could manage really simply. And then any other ideas like road plans, that was also included in there as well. So to review, the plot size for 7,650 square feet, the number of beds being 20 beds, which can be added on additional beds in the future in the following years. This is the first phase of the project. Those bed sizes being 4 feet by 2 feet by 8 feet. The irrigation system being a combination of not just city water, but also rain barrels, including the rope fence, the trellis, and the bench to create that community feel of ownership. And then launching in September with your approval. And then being proactive with our methods of sale, being that we already have half of them sold, or at least requested. And then the ROI being to reinvest the money earned back into the system, so this one-time cost of $5,000 will stimulate future projects with the community garden. And then creating a community garden that I mentioned, and then possibly adding on additional solar to, you know, maybe supplement a pump or something like that if we need to. Which I talked with the Department of Solar, and they had, you know, optioned that off to us as a possibility, but nothing solid yet. So at this time, I'll open up any comments, questions from council.
Nick, thank you very much. Comments from council?
I have one. You know, we're looking at rain barrels. Rain barrels predominantly are someplace where they can catch water. Where are we catching the water from?
So from the racquetball courts there, we'll add on a gutter system.
Okay.
And collect it from there. There already is one, and it all drains to one area, but we might make some minor improvements to that, which is in the budget.
Okay, thank you.
Further comments? Yeah. Nick, great job.
Thank you.
And to the Sustainability Committee. And I know they've been working on this stuff and really getting into it and doing a fabulous job. I mean, Mindy?
You call me Courtney. All right.
Everybody does that to me.
It's like, I know. I do think you guys are going to want to invest in the pumps for sure. I mean, just I have rain barrels at home, and I can tell you when you're trying to water long distance through a hose, you're going to find that it's, and I remember talking about this even when I was on sustainability, you're going to find that it's going to be difficult to get the water to those beds. I only speak that because I literally have 100 feet from my rain barrels to my beds, and I don't have a pump yet. So I definitely think that we should probably have budgeted for that, to be honest with you.
So the irrigation cost of the pump is about $250.
Okay.
And that should be enough to get us our with the head pressure from the rain barrels as well as tapping into the city irrigation.
So the barrels are all tied in tandem?
Into the,
yes.
They're catching everything off the roof.
So we stack our barrels three high. You're going to create enough head pressure to get to each of the garden beds. beds. And all the garden beds, being the size that they are and constructed the way that they are, should be able to be moved within that footprint if they need to be. If we had an issue where, you know, somebody needed to go through to get to the backside of the tennis courts, for example, I know that there is some traffic there. Sometimes you can see that there's traction from trucks. We can move the beds if need be. They're not too heavy.
My other question is, are you going to put any restrictions on, so are we going to be handling pesticides and that type of thing? Are we going to restrict what types of pesticides can be used on the beds? Are we going to allow, how are we going to handle that?
So in the language of the agreement that each of the residents or whomever is going to be purchasing the beds, I'll draft language that reflects what we allow to be acceptable behavior within that community, the community garden. The idea of which is to promote sustainable practices, environmentally friendly practices. So once that language is drafted, I'll bring that again before.
Okay.
The sustainability one.
That's all I have.
Great. Question. Is there any other irrigation out there at the present time? And there are sprinkler systems kind of around there?
Yes.
Okay. Because it's great, the rain barrels, but we haven't had rain, you know, if it was like we've been in this drought, so.
And when we do have rain, we have an excessive amount, so right. We want to be able to have capacity when needed, but also tap into the existing system.
Right.
And
so
that well
you need a pump, is what it looks like.
That's salt water in the irrigation system. That's not going to work on, that's not going to work on vegetables.
How is it, Alan? How is that system? Have we tested it?
The salinity of that water is not as high as in other areas. We'll definitely test it.
I mean, you know, if you've got people that are paying money to put plants in there, you want to make sure that we, you know, at least give them a positive, you know, result.
Part of your, or what we're asking you to do is to assign the management of the community garden to the sustainability board, and they will be writing up those, you know, requirements and all of the small details, like what we were just talking about, the irrigation. You know, if we don't have enough rain, where do we go to the next? And so they've already been discussing that, like is it too salty? We need to test it, or you know, some of them think it is, and some of them don't. You know, so until we get that done.
But we are. That is part of the.
Right.
I just want to make sure that's
process.
Part of the process.
I'm good with that.
Okay. Any further questions? At this time, I'll open this agenda item for public comment. Floor is open. Hearing none, bring it back to council.
I make a motion to authorize the expenditure of $5,000 from the Recycle Trust Fund for the construction of a community garden. Set the participation cost at $50 per bed and assign the management of the community garden to the sustainability board.
One question real quick on that before we have a second. Is the five, we need a pump. I mean, it seems like we need a pump.
It's included in the irrigation cost.
So the $5,000 will cover that, Nick?
Yes.
Okay. Since we're doing it, I don't want to be.
It says 10 feet PVC, 200 feet plus irrigation materials. The irrigation materials, that includes couplings, PVC, glue, pump. Yes.
Okay. I just want to make sure we have it.
I'll say that. The pump is included in the irrigation.
Okay. Thank you. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. I have a motion by, I apologize, who made the motion?
Dominic.
I have a motion by Councilman Montanaro, second by Councilwoman Gibson. Further discussion?
Councilman Breimer?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osborne?
Yes.
Councilwoman Gibson?
Yes.
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Mayor Patino?
Yes. Motion passes. Nick, thank you very much.
Thank you.
And to the Sustainability Board.
Thank you, Sustainability.
Thank you, Sustainability. Great job.
We have Jazzy from Sustainability back there.
Okay.
Representing.
If my numbering is correct, we're on 13 appointments to boards.
Correct.
Let me throw this out. We've had interviews tonight, but we also had interviews the other night for this new board position. I think this is a really important board since we've made this change. It went to voters. I think we need to not vote on the board until the meeting on the 15th, and each of us research this and meet with Courtney on how, you know, possibility to do it. One suggestion would be, as we did to, and I'm going to use the term sustainability, at that time it wasn't a board, that each council member picked a
person for the board, okay? And then we vote on the two alternates. And also, you know, we're going to have to stagger these, which I know is in there because...
We need to stagger, we don't want people all at once dropping off and making changes.
I think the board's very important, and I would like to see us take the time to review all the ones we got tonight, plus the ones that we interviewed in the past. That's just a suggestion here.
Consensus? Can I, well, yeah, I'm on board with it. I know that when we did the sustainability, I'm looking at this and I'm looking at some of the people, and if we come to the meeting and my pick is the same pick that Mark is picking, should we have a second pick? Because, I mean, we may run into that scenario. If you look at some of the people that have applied for this, you know, they're longstanding members on other boards, and there's a very good possibility we may be picking the same person.
We could.
We may run into that.
That's fine. Also, I would recommend, and I'm not sure if we can do this, Jim, correct me if I'm wrong here, I would meet with our city manager, meet with Department Head John on this too, and make sure we get this board set up. It's going to guide us for the next 3 or 5 years, 3 years, however these dates come out. So as we did in the sustainability, I think it worked fairly well. That waiting 2 weeks, I think, would be smart.
So in this list of names we have here, the new planning advisor group, that is all the people we have that we've interviewed or had applications. Is that correct?
You have to add Alex.
You have to add
Alex. No, there's one add to it. It's Alex.
Okay.
That wasn't on there, was Alex.
Okay.
A recommendation to you is in our packet, we have all the applications.
Right.
And at our desk, Alex's application was here. So I pulled mine out so I could go read them again and look at my notes. And, you know.
It'll be a busier board, because it's going to have both
components.
Right.
Components, right. I just want to make sure we're, okay, again, that's just my opinion.
And I would suggest, as you said, I think we just, when you make your pick, contact Courtney and say, this is who I would pick.
Yeah, let me know so I can tell people.
Okay, that person has been picked, or that person's already been nominated, that then you can go ahead and...
Right,
fine. This is who my second person would be.
Okay.
If we just funnel that all through the city manager, I think she can take care of.
I'm good with that.
How we take care of it.
Is that okay with everyone?
Yeah, I just want to be clear. Okay, here we go. Okay. Do we have the actual applications for?
Yeah, they're on the back.
They're in the packet.
It's the ones in the front.
Right, the ones in the front are the ones we did tonight.
Right there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just two?
No.
Just one? Two?
There's two that we did prior, and then there's the additional ones tonight.
Okay. I just wanted to, because we had a bunch of them, I was looking for there to be more back here.
I kept putting them on other things.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then they didn't want to leave.
Okay.
All right,
so that takes care of the new planning board. We have some others here. Harry Pollack.
I'll make a motion to reappoint Harry Pollack to the Firefighter and Police General Employee Pension Plan Board of Trustees as a primary member with a term ending 4/3/17.
I have a motion by Councilman Montanaro.
4/3/17.
Second by.
That's like April. There's something wrong with that date.
2020, right?
Yeah, it's 3 years.
4/3/20.
Amend my second. Motion by Councilman Montanaro, amended by Councilman Breiner. Further discussion? Lenore?
Councilman Gibson?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osmer?
Yes.
Councilman Breiner?
Yes.
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Mayor Patino?
Yes. Motion passed. On the sustainability board staggered term appointments, do we have to vote that in, or is that?
You'll just do it at the time you appoint. So okay. we'll make recommendations of the terms for each seat.
Okay, well, they're down okay. here. That's okay. Yes.
Yeah. Because the way we wrote the ordinance was it was your discretion.
Great. Okay. Okay.
That was Jim's idea.
Great. Thank you. Okay.
Well, when we do that, are we going to do the alternates also staggered? So they're going to have a staggered seat?
What do you think?
Will the alternates have a staggered, like, will one alternate go off at a different time than the other alternate, so that...
It's up to you.
Okay.
I'll sit with Lenore, and we'll go through it, and make a recommendation for it.
Yeah, is there an alternate with each of them?
Yes.
With each of them, three and one and two and one?
Yeah, yeah, that makes sense to me.
So as a point of clarification, you're going to bring back both the Planning Advisory Board and the Sustainability Board at the March 15th meeting, is that what you're indicating?
Not the Sustainability.
Just the Planning Advisory Board, and you and I...
Currently, you have no term ending date for the Sustainability Board members.
Right, so you and I will sit and make those term ending dates and make a recommendation to the council at the next meeting.
That's what I'm saying, for the March 15th meeting.
Yes.
So yes, that is correct, okay.
Thank you. Everybody good?
Yep.
Okay, moving on to Agenda Item 14, the proposed council agenda items for the 15th. Like we've always said in the past, need anything added, please see City Manager.
I just, real quick, Mayor, before we leave that, I wanted to give you a heads up on an item that the staff were thinking about. One of your council goals was to engage the business community. So we were discussing that, how to do that, and we may be looking at creating some committees of volunteers to help us reach out to the businesses and try to get their participation in our chambers, and also talk to them about sustainability practices at the same time, and kind of divide businesses up by type, and ask, you know, teams of three to go out and visit some of them. So we will be coming back to you with an agenda item, basically giving us permission to go ahead and start pooling volunteers for that purpose. So I just wanted to let you know that was coming. So if you have any ideas on what you would like us to focus on and things like that, I know this is really Councilwoman Gibson's issue, and so obviously she's going to be involved. But if you have any input that you would like to give us, you know, please let us know. And
let me ask this question. Is the only thing you need is a consensus from us to say, go ahead and start, or do you want this to be an agenda?
I'm going to put an agenda item together.
And then give it to you. Okay.
Yeah. But if you have any, you know, ideas in the meantime, you know, think about it and let us know, because it's going to be fun. You know, we'll be able to go out and meet the businesses and come up with some good ideas and figure out how to best to serve them. And
thank you. Thank you, Councilman Gibbs. Again, any other agenda items, please see City Manager. Moving on to Agenda Item 15.
I make a motion to approve the City Council regular meeting minutes from the February 15, 2017 meeting as submitted.
I have a motion by Councilman Montanaro, second by Councilman Breimer. Further discussion? Hearing none, Lenore?
Councilman Gibson?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Osmer?
Yes.
Councilman Breimer?
Yes.
Councilman Montanaro?
Yes.
Mayor Patino?
Yes. Motion passes. I believe we've covered everything. Any other business before council? Hearing none. Thank you, everybody. Meeting's adjourned.